go-go intro music?
That sounds like Inspector Gadget.
Beep boop intro music. Welcome to Cypher Sci-Fi. We explore how and why. I'm Christopher Peterson.
I'm Lee Colbert.
And together we protect the Earth from evil trying to steal its life force and think too hard about science fiction tropes. We watched something.
We did. It's the Power Rangers, the one released in 2017, not like 20 years ago.
Oh, wait, you're telling me I shouldn't have watched all 17 seasons of the Power Rangers?
If you had some time to kill.
Did I overprepare for this episode? In real life, no. I watched the movie. We both watched the movie. And in fact, I don't think I've ever seen an episode of the show.
You have to have had.
I'm the oldest of a bunch of children. And the other ones, the younger ones, definitely watch the show. So I've seen it around, but I have no idea. I think this is good for our approach on this episode now, is I have basically no idea about what any of the things were in the show.
Me too. That makes us the best people to talk about it.
I think that is good, because now we're not, our approach is not going to be tainted by having too much information about the universe and the canon of the shows, assuming they're even coherent, which I wouldn't. Spoiler alert, gonna spoil the movie. What's Power Rangers about?
It's a good question.
There's a crystal?
Yeah. So Heisenberg finds a bunch of teenagers to give superpowers to and protect the planet from evil.
Yeah, he was the one who knocks with meteors, and team of teenagers band together to save Earth. So the movie does open with a brief scene with Heisenberg as the Red Ranger, I guess at the end of an arduous battle, because they're all like dead. They're all dying. He's the last one.
He's crawling away.
It opens and it says it's a Cenozoic era on the title card. And that's all we're given.
Which we see flying creatures, which we can only assume are pterodactyls or something similar.
Or something, yeah.
Pterodons.
I think it's an interesting choice to put Cenozoic era on there because that's the one we're in.
But then people are like, oh, that's when the dinosaurs went extinct.
But they
it's the age of the mammal, right?
Saying 65 million years ago or something, you know, or because they say that later, 65 million years ago.
But Chris, this is common knowledge.
Just saying Cenozoic era is so broad.
Looks like there's some volcanism because it is a super grim environment that they're fighting in. It's all dark and grimy.
Yeah, I wondered about that. We see pterodactyls or something, and we also see volcanoes, and everything kind of looks just real rubbish. Like, it looks apocalyptic, let's say. And I wonder what that's trying to suggest about that moment and that period where they are and the end of the dinosaurs and a lot of other species. We always talk about the end of the dinosaurs as the dinosaurs all died and there was a meteor or whatever, but we'd probably do better to phrase it more in terms of the extinction event in general, because so much stuff died. It just so happens that a lot of the larger ones at the top of the food chain were the dinosaurs. Probably also worth remembering that it was, I think most of our audience will have this in mind, but I think a lot of people consider that extinction event like it was a momentary event. It was an acute, this thing happened, meteor hits, everything dies type situation, which I'm not sure what we know in detail, but I'm pretty sure we have the idea that it was more drawn out.
Yep. I think we've talked, or at least Joe has brought this up. But it was in War Games where it was a debate around whether or not it was volcanism or the meteor or some combination thereof.
Right. Because and I was blown away by this. I had no idea. Because it's something you grew up with it. You just think it's the way we know the world. But
and if you're older than that, it was like volcanoes. And older than that, it was, you know, God. It was like.
That seemed like a good answer at the time. When War Games came out, you're right. Yeah. And the movie. It's a funny place to find to talk about volcanoes and the KT extinction, but or whatever they call it now, because there's a newer word, where it was actually, we hadn't really settled on the impact hypothesis for that extinction event yet. That's very interesting. Yeah. And so I'm not sure what they're trying to portray in the movie exactly. This could be the aftermath of the impact where the sky is dark and everything's rubbish and, you know, all the food is dying and those pterodactyls are going to be really sad soon when they starve.
Although, if anyone that knows dinosaurs is listening, we have no idea. We just have some common names for dinosaurs. Pterodactyls.
It should be said, I guess, a common name that I think people in the know academically would usually not use and would use the particular particular genus or whatever.
A flying dinosaur of some variety. Anyhow, there does seem to be an active volcano in the background in some of the shots.
Right. We seem to be pretty settled now on the impact hypothesis, but don't forget that it came after the volcanism hypothesis was, I guess, the leading idea. And in both cases, they're not too far from each other. I mean, the causes are different, but they're both mainly killing everything by throwing stuff up in the air. The one is destroying a very large area of the land around Mexico or wherever, somewhere. But in both cases, they are spewing ash and rock and detritus in general into the air, then depriving plants of what they need, then depriving the animals of the plants, et cetera, so on, and then you're left with tiny rodents. Yep. This is all stuff that they do not talk about in the movie, because that scene is only like a minute long.
You have 20 minutes of just Morgan Freeman narrating over it.
If Morgan Freeman did it,
now we see the end of the dinosaurs.
But speaking of impactors, the end of Bryan Cranston
is a trump card called throw a rock at it from space.
Yeah, that's my favorite move. He's Zap Brannigan'd it. But cut to modern times and kids are jerks.
You know what? That's really just got to be a part of getting older.
What?
All this irresponsibility by these jerky teenagers.
Well, okay, well, they start out in like detention and there's a suspect that wants to break people's wrists. That's one thing.
No, even before that, with the cow prank. Yeah, okay, whatever. It's a cow prank. But then let's drive recklessly away from the cops, turn off my headlights, and then gloat about it and then have an accident.
And then crash. Yeah, but just general, maybe, I don't know if that's what they were going for. I don't know if most of the audience or the expected audience for the film was going through this set of feelings, but it was like, wow, kids are terrible.
And then he injured himself.
I do like the one kid, though. The Spurgy kid.
The one that was getting picked on by the bully?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's an affectation of the awareness of the spectrum. What? We're starting to see individuals on the spectrum in more movies. I was thinking, like, you had the accountant, for instance, was one. And now we have a Power Ranger who is a kid on the spectrum.
Yeah, I haven't done a survey, but I've enjoyed both of those characters very much. I wonder if it's something we're going to be sick of when it's a trope. But in both cases, they are the hero, and in this case, is a superhero. That's pretty cool. We've come a long way from the portrayals of nerds of yesteryear, like Steve Urkel style, you know? Because he's not just on the spectrum, but also fits within that nerd, you know, the nerd. It's more subtle now, a little bit. And it's actually his irresponsible behavior, as much as I like that character, it's actually his irresponsible behavior that brings them to be the superheroes. Because he goes blowing up unstable rock formations. Like, whatever he's doing, it's really important. And he winds up uncovering, like, a glass thing and some crystals.
Yes, a large crystalline structure with
smaller crystals.
With shinies inside. Embedded in it.
Did he call them power crystals? That's when we find the power crystals that have a name that I don't remember.
Coins?
They call them coins? I don't know. Don't look at me. These are the thing that make them Power Rangers, somehow. And I guess there's, in the vein of, like, the One Ring, or maybe something with the Force or whatever, there's, like, there seems to be some agency to them that they seek out or whatever, you know, kind of like the ring again, the right one. Although the ring is evil and this.
Although it didn't do very much seeking. It
just stayed inside of a
rock. Yeah, it was incredibly passive. It stayed in one spot until an accurate number of people got to it.
Yeah, it happened to be the right five. But imagine if they had like a sixth friend with them that they didn't like that much and they weren't fast enough and they didn't get the stone. And then, like, they're left out of that whole superhero.
You're the Brown Ranger, because you're a shit. Get out of here.
Get fucked, loser.
Punch him. Give him a wedgie. Yeah, so we wouldn't be Power Rangers.
We don't have the right spirit of fraternity to make it as Power Rangers, but I guess they do.
But they don't at first.
What?
They were being questioned, Zordon. Zordon? Heisenberg. Heisenwall. Yeah, so it wasn't like they were a tight-knit group right off the bat. They were a bunch of strangers.
Yeah, they barely knew each other. Or some of them not at all.
And they couldn't morph. They couldn't even morph.
That's disgusting.
You get that? Yeah.
What a disappointment, these kids. But it's summed up in their mission. Their mission of Power Rangers in general, and apparently there's a lot of them around, is to protect life. and life that they protect is all based around the life-giving crystal that is on Earth. The crystal happens to be under a Krispy Kreme that they keep talking about. Like, was that an ad placement thing? That was weird.
It has to be.
It was so strange.
Because it must be a special place.
It's just they did it so much that it felt like parody, and I thought, I was trying to figure out what joke they were making. But I think they were just heavy-handed. Good for them, though, making that buck. So here, we got to address now the life crystal that they are protecting. Because life on Earth, apparently, came from that crystal. Is one of those? Is this the Prometheus problem again? The crystal variant?
It's just, yes. Just generic seeding, I guess. That's what life is, Chris.
None of them are.
There's a generic blueprint that follows. If you have a crystal that makes life, it may be working off the same template, okay? It made one. It was like, this is good enough.
Yeah,
this thing's got four butts with another butt on a butt.
See how this thing does. Sucker. See, we don't actually have a lot of information. Again, I want the org chart. I want more about the whole thing. I want a packet. I want like a binder. Like I've just gotten a new job in a new company. And here's all the stuff.
It is, if you are red, you're the leader. Everyone else is below.
Yes, that's about the level of explanation that we receive almost from Heisenwald.
Yes. If you haven't gotten it yet, Heisenwald is Zordon. We just prefer him as Heisenberg because...
Well, because every time I try to say Zordon, I say Zoidberg and I get confused, and it's not worth it. So Heisenwald. But it's worth talking about his thing.
Is he integrated into the ship? Because that could be fine.
Oh, yeah, sure. Why not, right? Well, he didn't get turned on until the kids came in with their crystals or whatever. I think the robot was there the whole time. So there's also the robot. You might know this guy from Power Rangers, Alpha 5.
Alpha 5, if you don't like unnecessary pauses.
In the middle of a word, no less.
Yes, Alpha 5.
That was me remembering what it was. The obnoxious robot, android, in fact, is what he calls himself.
No, he said, I'm a robot.
And then he also said android.
That's confusing.
It is. That's the problem.
What is he shaped as?
You know what, man? Maybe just chalk it up to linguistic differences and the language barrier, because he is not from here. He has been here for 65 million years, but they speak another language on the ship. He and Heisenwald speak an alien language. And also, Heisenwald spoke it earlier on with both the bad guy and the other yellow ranger that died. They didn't mention it in the movie. They didn't even make hay about it. And they didn't really talk about it again. But I looked it up. And if we look at the old canon, this was the extent of my old Power Rangers research, because the language thing got me. It's called
Eltar.
I was going to say Erlang. Imagine if they spoke Erlang. But no, Eltar.
For his home planet.
Yes. So he is Eltarian, I suppose. And he speaks Eltar. And we found that it was a language created by Christine Schreier, who also did Kryptonian in that movie we enjoyed covering.
First few minutes of?
Man of Steel.
Primarily.
Which was half of her episode. Yeah, all the Krypton stuff. So she's done this a couple of times now. I saw an interview with her where she was talking about a little... She didn't get into like academic level detail with her language bits, but she did mention a couple of things like how this is... She didn't talk about it the same way, but this is the same thing that we heard from Nick Farmer when he was on talking about his design of the Expanse language, the Belter, where the showrunners would come to him and they'd be like, all right, we need it to be like harsh, but, you know, creamy. And then on the other side, it's like light and dark. And
harsh, but creamy.
Make it feel smooth.
Not like smooth or velvety, but creamy.
I'm trying to pick inappropriate adjectives. And the point is, though, that like they give you all these things and you're like, okay, is the answer. But in real life, like you can't do that. Those instructions are not useful in general for doing the thing.
Can you make it mushy, but also like a stealth cracker?
But anyway, she did, for her part, take a lot. The one thing they gave her that was a useful direction was to call upon sort of ancientness. Because these guys have been doing this for how long? 65 million years at least.
So it's Latin.
65 million years ago, Latin?
Sounds right.
Not quite. No, but she did pull from foreign sounding old stuff, because Latin doesn't feel very unfamiliar to us, unfortunately for her. So she was touching on like Aramaic and like ancient Greek and a bunch of other things that are recognizable word names, but that you probably wouldn't realize the sounds as much, the sounds and constructions. And also, as far as morphology goes, she tried to make like long, complicated words, because these were like an erudite advanced race sort of thing. And while you're still making human listenable sounds from a human mouth, that's pretty much the best you could do, I guess. Because what they do say is they speak a primitive dialect called English. And they sound all snobby about it. But what could that mean, do you think? If I say that, if we say that about another language on Earth, where there's no way we're doing anything other than just being jerks.
Unless they were lacking concepts.
Yeah, but none of them have that. Every language that humans speak, for real, is capable of expressing all the things that humans need to express. Sometimes you need to invent new words, but you just invent new words. And they're all differently complex in different ways a lot of the time, but they're all capable of human expression. That's the one requirement of a human language, is that humans can use it to express human thoughts. And that's what they all do. So when they come down with their jerky Eltar language and looking down on our English, in this case, it's possible that there's something else going on too. What if the informational density of their speech is actually like incredibly high in a way that we could never really hope to fluently understand? In which case, maybe English is a primitive dialect.
Could just be primitive purely by time.
Oh, yeah, that's not unreasonable, is it?
No.
Maybe that's how they meant it, right?
Like, when you've been speaking that for a million years, come back. And if you are at least a little bit dynamic in what your concept of primitive can mean, it could mean, hey, your language is fluidic and constantly changing. It is not the dominant language. That's primitive.
Yeah.
This language hasn't changed in, you know, however long.
Huh. Language has changed over time for us, humans. Part of that is that humans die, I think. But these guys apparently can live millions of years, especially like underground or in the water or whatever. So that's...
in various harsh conditions.
So maybe the conditions of how language works for them, even though we appear similar, is quite different. Maybe they can be static for however it is that their intelligence works, despite their ability to communicate with us fluently in English and sound like a colloquially speaking human. Maybe they can learn Eltar. But the first thing they're learning, actually, is how to fight.
Sure, because they have 11 days.
I love this. Wait. So the fate of all life on Earth hangs in the balance. And they have 11 months, no days, 11 days, and they still go to school.
Sure.
Come on, man.
You have to keep your cover story up, Chris.
I thought that was the funniest thing. They didn't even make a point of it or a joke about it. Like, they just... They had a montage of training, alternating with going to school and doing normal teenager stuff. Now, this also brings up questions about like team selection.
And was there any?
I'm not sure anymore. Because they could imagine if you were trying to save Earth from an evil thing that's going to take all the life away, right? We were thinking that maybe there's like some agency to the thing, like the One Ring style. But I'm not sure what it's basing that on, because. If you have 11 days to train these people to save the world and they have to use Kung Fu, like, there are people who've been doing that their entire lives. How many high-level martial combatists do you think there are on Earth? And how many of them have, like, the personality to be on a team and work in a team?
But they had the right stuff, and that's what matters.
Yeah, and what, I guess, we don't know. We are just primitive Earthlings. We don't know what the selection process really was on the magical end. The problem is, when I looked for like crystal power science stuff, like, it's impossible because
your chakras were aligned.
Because of all that like pseudoscience-y
rubbish? Rubbish, bunk, hooey.
Yeah, well, no, those are all words for it. It's hard to find any actual answers in that sort of thing. But why are they even training? What's 11 days?
Goldar.
Rita and Goldar.
Yep. Goldar will be formed, and he will rip the Zeo crystal out of the Earth.
Which would be bad.
Yes, it will be as bad as 10,000 nukes going off at the same time.
So Rita controls Goldar, whatever Goldar may be. And yeah, 10,000 nukes, that was a quote. That's a lot.
Sure.
He might have just been throwing that out there, but as a robot, I think he would be able to be precise. And I wonder if he meant that, in which case...
Unless he's just trying to impress upon them that it's bad. Like, you know a nuke's bad, so imagine 10,000 of them.
You know what's worse than one bad thing? 10,000 bad things.
Yeah, like, oh no, there's a bee in the car. I'm like, yeah, a bee. And oh no, there's 10,000 bees in the car.
That would be so much worse. You're right, I'm convinced. And in the case of the bees and in the case of the nukes, it would not go well. In both cases. It would be really bad.
The bees are more of a your problem.
That's what I mean.
The entire world's.
In the analogy I in the car am life on Earth.
It's a great analogy.
But they're making, she's making Goldar is actual, she, while she has superpowers too and kick people a lot, she is, her dastardly plan is to make Goldar, who will dig for her. And Goldar is a it turns out, a giant monster made of gold. Like, literally made, it seems, entirely of actual gold.
I mean, why choose gold?
I don't know.
It's pliable. It's ductile.
And
it's
when,
not really reactive.
And when you're magic, you can make it melt a lot without having to heat it directly in a way that is visible. But this is a monster that was like 50 feet tall or something. Like, we're talking King Kong, you know? Or one of the King Kongs, not the last one. Large. Quite large.
Yep, and molten.
That's a lot of gold. That's like, that's, where's she getting that? That's a lot of hobo teeth.
You saw her. She was able to pull it directly out of the gold mine.
Oh, it was coalesced. A gold mine.
Yeah.
She really takes her time getting to the gold mine, though. She's like pulling people's teeth. She's robbing the jewelry store. Yep.
Waste not, want not. You know, find a penny on the ground, pick it up.
That's
it contributes to your giant penny monster.
If pennies were hobo's teeth.
Yes.
Now, how much gold does she need? She has magic and she's able to get out of a mine. I wonder how much could be in a mine that has been used for decades. But I tried to do a little math on it. So trying to figure out how much gold that is, because he seems to be made entirely of gold. I looked up how heavy the Megazord is, which is the Power Rangers robot fighting guy. 570 tons.
It's pretty beefy.
So they're kind of the same size, and they're both made of metal, and they're not the same, but let's just, for argument's sake, say that they weigh the same. Gold's heavy. 570 tons.
Probably heavier than the metals used to construct the Megazord.
Let's just say conservatively, 570 tons. That is actually a lot for her. I mean, she plucked some guy's teeth and she robbed a jewelry store.
That's a lot of teeth and rings.
But that, yeah. She went to the mine and pulled it out of the mine. That is, when I say 570, in a year, the whole world mining gold will pull out like 2,500 tons.
That was a really good mine, whoever owned that.
Right, so that...
they missed out. That's like...
that one mine is like a fifth of the world's gold output for the entire year.
We're talking hundreds of millions of dollars.
How much would it be? Because we know how much... if we assume we know how much it weighs.
So, because I know the actual price of gold, which I don't, I looked it up. if you do a little math, probably about 600 million.
That's pretty good. However... remember what happened when the Spanish brought back all that gold and dumped it on the market?
Yes. However, there was concern because their town just got wrecked. But now they have $600 million of gold sitting in a pile.
Yes. Just saying, your $600 million of gold isn't worth $600 million when you try to dump it all on the market at once. So be careful, Angel Grove or whatever. Yeah, and for reference, because like imagine how big that is. It's a 50-foot person would be that big. But also, Fort Knox would be... a good place to get your gold if you were trying to make a giant
there's
monster.
Way more than necessary there.
They have thousands of tons. Like, I know they have a lot of gold, right? And there's other places where we do that. And other countries also have lots of gold, like, physically stored someplace. But, like, I couldn't... like, how many tons is that? I have no idea. Like, I've never picked up a pallet of gold before.
That would be very impressive.
They'd be so impressed.
What's this? Oh, it's a pallet of gold.
They'd be so impressed they'd let me walk out. Well played. But, yeah. But what was it? Thousands of tons is a standard thing that you'd see across many different countries. Even hundreds of thousands of tons in general. But in one place, that actually would have been a good place. I guess the gold mine is not terrible, assuming there's still plenty of gold down there and you have magic gold melting power. Because that is the process for mining metal anyway. Break rock, melt rock, take metal.
But I just think you give everyone a handful of gold. And probably keep doing that.
You don't need to give them a handful of gold. They had it splattered all over their houses and cars. I mean, if you weren't scalded and maybe killed by that whole splattering of molten gold, like, your car now has, like, thousands of dollars sitting on top of it. So, you know, and maybe it's worth more than the car.
Please, wreck my car.
Because the melting temperature of gold is it's almost 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's
pretty spicy right there.
You don't want that to land on you. It's very dangerous when he was slopping it all over the place.
Well, you know, that's a whole ROI calculation right there.
What?
How much gold do you get on you and where? Like, do I lose a foot's worth of gold?
It's 2,000 degrees. That's hot. That guy's a mess. And when they beat him up, he melts. I don't know what's going on there. But they beat him up with their giant dinosaur robo monster, which started as...
how is that supposed to work?
What?
So he's a molten, coherent blob of gold.
Yeah.
So you punch him.
Yep.
Okay. So you splatter a bit of him about.
Yep.
Doesn't he just T-1000 it back in?
Or fly through him, which is, yeah, he just, it seems like he just healed up.
So the trick would be to kick Rita with a Zoid kick.
Yeah. Or a Zoid.
Snip, snip.
That would be the trick, although she seems to be able to withstand quite a punch. But they have a giant robot to punch stuff. They do a pretty good job. It starts as separate robot things. Because I guess this is like a standard issue Power Ranger item. Their Zords, as they're called, are the robot vehicles. They're told that they take the form of their most powerful creature that's on the planet when they are like instantiated.
Yeah, but I mean, what's the qualifier for that? Because is it the amount of force it can generate?
Yeah.
In absolute terms? Is it relative? Because do you wind up with like a mantis shrimp for one of them?
Mantis shrimp. That's nice.
Right.
Yeah. Force production per mass, right?
You got one beefy claw and it punches really fast.
Dude,
but the rest of you, really kind of weak.
But you look so pretty. And that would be awesome. I want a mantis shrimp Zord.
Bam.
Bam. Sonic boom. The whole city explodes. Can you imagine the force necessary to make the hand move that fast when it's that big? That'd be crazy. It would be so much better, too, because the thing about this is that if these were all modeled after the most powerful creatures on the planet at the time, I'm going to list them for you. Tell me if you can find anything that's like strange about this. Red is Tyrannosaurus Rex. Blue is a Triceratops.
Also pretty sweet.
Pink was like a Pterodon, Pterodactyl, something or other, whatever. Flying Dino.
Okay, you need something airborne. I get that.
So far, so good.
Yeah.
Yellow is a saber-toothed tiger, which is a suspiciously large mammal. And then finally, black is a woolly mammoth, which I didn't know to be fierce attack animals so much.
They can trample you.
But I do know them to be very large mammals. And the main thing to notice about that is, if you think about the timeline of life on Earth.
It was a really long fight.
When you have...
Really long. It took a minute.
Maybe that's the trick. Because what I'm trying to say is that when you have megafauna like dinosaurs, you don't have megafauna like any of the big mammals, the mega mammals. You wouldn't have had these at that time. We were quite underfoot when the dinosaurs were around. And don't forget, we did see that there were flying dinosaurs in the beginning of the movie when the whole thing went down. So that's interesting that that happened. There must be something we don't know.
Maybe he lied. He was like, these things are sweet. Pretty awesome, man. We're going to make these. Totally not a choice to make action figures and sell them to kids.
Oh, yeah.
But they were totally the strongest creatures on the planet.
The best part about it is it does... Who's Voltron? Right? But that's what they do. They have to join their dinosaur or something, maybe most of them, but not all of them, vehicles together to make a robot that they would control. They seem to control their part, like a leg and an arm and a head or whatever.
Seems like a bad idea.
Terrible idea. Have you ever played Octodad?
Have you ever played Quap?
Oh, that's good. Yeah.
But imagine you're in a fight and you're like, okay, arm, throw a left hook and don't move any other part of your body.
And then like Voltron, they do the swords. They pull out their swords.
Except he has two swords.
And they were
wings.
Stabs the gold guy and it's over?
And she's like, no, I'd rather die. She attacks and he slaps her off the earth. Literally.
Yeah, this is incredible. So
that was weird.
I was laughing so hard. It's just, she's left alone. She's facing the giant robot. She jumps up to attack the giant robot like manually, which I don't know how that was going to work, but superpowers. But it's backhand into space.
So just think about that.
Yeah.
She can survive 65 million years.
Underwater or something.
Doesn't matter, somewhere.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
She wound up in the water at some point. And she can survive being slapped off the planet.
Slapping doesn't sound that bad, but if you're slapped off of the planet...
That's a lot of instantaneous force.
That is significant. And think about it too, like...
Instantaneous acceleration.
Yeah, yeah, that's the thing that makes it even worse too. Because like if you look at a rocket and a rocket pushes really hard for a really fast time and it goes up there, but it's gradual still. It's not like a bullet. Yeah, like you don't just shoot a bullet into space. We're talking about there was a single acceleration.
That's why we talk about G's of acceleration. We're used to 1G.
For reference, it would be like 6 or 7 times the speed. The 6 or 7 times the acceleration of like a bullet is what we're looking at to get her to do that, which is a lot of energy to put into a human-sized thing.
Yeah, so escape velocity is 11.2 kilometers a second.
Mm-hmm.
And you got that all with one slap.
To the moon. And to the moon she goes. Apparently, the show, the real one, the old one, had her based on the moon. And she would throw monsters down or something.
That's pretty sweet.
So, yeah. I learned this from a video, which I think I'll recommend at the end. Speaking of which, the blue guy dies, but then he comes back. They kill Reedish, goes to the moon, and then they go to detention. The end. What do we learn?
If you find shiny coins in a crystal thing, in a mountain that your friend recklessly blew up after you did a bunch of dumb things, you're going to be a superhero?
Congratulations, you earned it.
No, that's probably not what I should have learned.
Damn kids. Teamwork. The power of teamwork is what you learned, Colbert.
Yeah, and I don't think you can kill Rita.
Oh, and also, apparently she's indestructible. You need to
slap her into the sun next time.
It's going to be hard. Yeah, that might work. If there's a thing we have at our disposal.
Although, I've learned it's hard to slap people into the sun. Just in general.
From Fraser Kane. Yes. You have to very carefully calculate that sun slap. And I don't know that the AI is up to the task in the moment. So, recommended related stuff. The thing I just mentioned. The idea that she's on the moon in the old show and would throw her staff down to make monsters on Earth from the moon. I never watched the show, really. I saw little bits and pieces. But I did recently catch a show on YouTube. It's called Because Science. It's on Nerdist. Kyle Hill is the host. And he had an episode about, well, actually it was titled, Is Rita Repulsa's Staff More Destructive Than Her Monsters? The point being that in the old show, not in the new one yet, but they seem to be setting up the sequel from the moon thing. In the old show, she would throw her staff down to Earth.
Mm-hmm.
It would stick into the crust, and then a monster would happen. And if you take a look at how fast that was happening and calculate from the supposed mass of the object, like what would happen, that's like a city-destroying or Earth-destroying impact, depending on how you work the velocity.
So she throws it at a significant fraction of the speed of light?
That's exactly it, yeah. For the first look, I thought it was really interesting. Because the first look, it's like, oh, that sucks. You're like going to destroy New York or whatever. Then
oh, no, it went through the Earth.
But then if you look in the show at how fast it goes to Earth, then, yeah, we're talking about, again, a significant portion of speed of light, which once you do that, a lot of stuff happens. It's bad.
So you just throw the staff, which becomes a ball of plasma continuously exploding.
Yes, quite
just throw it at the Rangers and stuff.
Quite remarkable that it stays in this form of a golden staff. But magic, I guess. Anyway, I thought that was a fun video. And it's about Power Rangers. It's not about the movie, but it might be related to the second one, because the second one, we did see her floating around smirking by the moon. What else we got?
So Adi Shankar did, it was like a short, kind of darker look at the Power Rangers.
Yeah, so you gotta know this guy, because he's really weird and he does really cool stuff a lot of the time. He produced, in particular, most notable, is he produced Dredd. The modern masterpiece Dredd. Not the awesome Camp 90s masterpiece Dredd, which we also enjoyed on the show. But he produced Dredd. As far as real movies go, that's his main thing that I would point to. But he's weird and crazy, and he does stuff. Like, I love this part. He just makes things. He makes shorts because he wants to. And, like, he's just a cowboy. I don't know. So the one that he made the Punisher short with Thomas Jane. But the Power Rangers unauthorized bootleg thing that he did was a really cool, like, You might be getting sick of the dark and gritty adaptation, you know, of like comic books and whatnot, but it looks pretty sweet. And I don't even know the Power Rangers, but it looked like a really good time. And I am very interested in anything he does. So when I heard that this movie was happening, this was a few years ago, when I heard this movie was happening, I thought that meant that the Adi Shankar Power Rangers was getting made. And I'm
way too much murder.
I'm a little disappointed.
Way too many people dying.
It's not PG-13.
Yeah, that's not related to the television series people would be familiar with.
But it's so cool. It's really cool. And this guy does really cool work. I'm going to put that video and the other video that he talked about it in the show notes too, because Power Rangers. And that's recommended related things. You should probably go to the show notes and click on them and watch them, because they're pretty sweet. The science thing and the murdery Power Rangers thing. And another thing you could do is consider supporting your creators. Whether we're the thing you want to support or whoever it is that's making a thing on the internet that you're really enjoying lately, consider helping them out. A lot of creators these days are involving themselves in ways where their fans can support them and help them make their thing, and please consider doing so. We have some people who are supporting us doing our thing. They are amazing.
Graham, they might even be called Mighty.
I don't know that they morph, but Mighty. They are Mighty Joe Ferraro, Dean at LSG Media, Nicholas Little Boy Low, Daniel the Outlander, Robert is Robert, Jeremy, Andy P. from Batch 25 Comics, Brian the Sexiest Brother Peterson, Peter Van Loon the Dutchman, Andrew Capitulo the Mighty, Jeff Firemish Warman, Chris Gennard, Mr. Raygun Curly Phil, Michael the Giantess Peterson, Sam Mumby, Igor Smolensky, Joe Ruppel, our Kobe FF, John Champion of Giant Zord Beavers, Daniel James Barker from Certainty Principle, the podcast, Adrian Falcone of this podcast sometimes, my mom, DJ Space Witch Moffat, on the moon, Grandma Judy, and
we're sorry.
And Magical Zordicorn Jolene Creighton. Thanks, everybody. These people are great. So if you'd consider joining them on this list of amazing people who help us make this thing, then decipherscipher.com/support the show.
You can also support us by telling others, by sharing us with people that you think is our audience. decipherscipher.com/subscribe.
And that's the end. We got to get out of here. Colbert, please, let's both of us stop trying to justify this whole thing and admit you're in danger.
I am the danger. A guy opens his heart and gets his armor, and you think that of me? No, I am the one who gets his armor. I forgot what I said.
Morphs.
No.
Take two. Bunk.
No, I am the one who morphs.
That was excellent.
Zoidberg? Heisenwallberg? What's his name? What?
What's the character's name?
Zordon.
Zoran Zoidberg.
Zordon.
Zord.
Sotek? What? Salsa? What's his name? Xerxes.